Κυρίες και κύριοι, καλησπέρα σας. Καλώς ήρθατε στο Αθεσπά Show. Τελευταίος ομιλητής για σήμερα στην 29 είναι ο κύριος Ιαν Μπαρέλ. Οι πιο πολλοί από εσάς το ξέρουν να έχουμε ξανά την επόμενη. Σήμερα λοιπόν θα μας μιλήσει για την επιστροφή. Να μας πει για το τι κύριαμα ήταν ελληνική έρνηση και να μας πει ουσιαστικά έτσι όπως είχε ονομάσει το δικό του σεμινάριο η επιστροφή του Μαλάκα. Το επιχείρημα του Μαλάκα με ένα ρούμι που θα μας εξηγήσει εκείνος τι ακριβώς πρόκειται. Ιαν!
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Ένα χειροκρότημα λοιπόν.
One, two, one, two. Good evening, everybody. Evening.
Hey.
You know what I love about... sorry, first of all, I want to apologize because my Greek is terrible. So I have to do this presentation in really bad English. Is that cool? Excellent. What I love about doing a session at, what time is it?
7.
What I like to do at 7 o'clock on the second day of a bar show is everybody's drunk. And everyone's like, I don't give a fuck what you say, Ian, just make it funny. And give us some shots of rum. So that's what you're gonna get. You're gonna be funny and shots of rum. And then we go and party. Is that cool?
Yeah,
excellent. Right, so, my name is Ian Burrell. I'm the global ambassador for rum. And today we're gonna talk about if tiki was Greek. I actually did a presentation about 4 years ago. Did anyone see this 4 years ago? One person, two, oh shit, okay, you got three, four, oh. I really apologize, you might hear the same bad jokes that I did 4 years ago. But for all you new people, this is new for you guys. So, does anyone like tiki?
Yay!
Yay! Does anyone like the Greeks?
Yay!
So can you imagine if tiki was inspired by Greeks? Can you imagine? Not by the Caribbeans. No offense to the guys from Trinidad, but Jamaica, we run things. Not inspired by Polynesia, like Tahiti and all those type of places, because they don't have rum there. They have lots of clues, but they don't have rum. Imagine if tiki was inspired by Greece. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you guys to an alternative universe. One thing is important to remember, and this is what Socrates said thousands of years ago. I cannot teach anybody anything. I cannot teach anyone anything. I can only make them think. And this is what I want you to do. I'm not going to teach you anything today. Well, maybe you might learn something. But what I'm going to do is make you think. And make you think, hey shit, I can create that cocktail. That's easy. Or maybe I can do this in my bar. That's easy. That's what this session is about. It's about making you think. So, let's start. Once upon a time. That's how I like to start stories. Because we all like stories like that. Once upon a time. Once upon a time, in another world, tiki was Greek. Don't laugh, it's not that funny. Tiki was Greek. That's what tiki was about. That's where it came from. That was all the inspiration. That's every single cocktail that you've ever heard of was inspired by Greece, as in tiki cocktails, in the alternative world. Even the brand, I'm not even there in this alternative world. This is the global ambassador for rum in the tiki world. Mr. Nikos. I'm actually photobombing him in that picture. He's not photobombing me. Because in this world, he is the global ambassador for rum. Mr. Nikos. Yeah man, he calls himself the Greek Rasta. But anyway, it's another world. I have a friend, some of you may know him.
Thank you.
His name is Jeff Stavros Berry. Jeff Stavros Berry in this alternative world. It's not a real world, alternative world. He's gonna give us some pearls of wisdom. Jeff can't be here today, but I'm gonna ask him a few questions. Jeff, who actually invented Greek tiki?
So Jeff, what was his name?
Well, before Trader Mykonos, the trade was heavily influenced by Babas the Beachcomber. The first Greeky bar was invented by Babas back in 1933 in Athens.
So apparently, the first Greek tiki bar in the alternative world was created by Babas the Beachcomber. Babas the Beachcomber, that's the person that created the very first tiki bar in the alternative world. And if you've never seen Babas before in this world, he's a very slim man with lots of hair and loves rum. So this is the person that created tiki in the alternative world. But get you back into what exactly is tiki? When we talk about cocktails or culture, what is exactly tiki? Well, technically, tiki is like a large statue, a large totem pole. It's a way of expressing yourself to the gods as such. And that's what tiki was. Tiki, in some cultures, was the first man or the first woman as well. So tiki was a religion. It was a religion. And this is what I like to see with rum. Rum is a religion. Yeah? So when we talk about tiki, this is what inspired the whole tiki cocktails. Of course, tiki statues. But there's a lot of similarities to Greece. So the tiki statues were all based around gods and deities. And of course, Greek mythology, which is one of my favorite subjects, is based around gods and deities. Like, Silenus. Anyone know Silenus? No? Well, the reason why you may not know Silenus, you may know his student. But Silenus was the Greek god of rum partying. He drank lots of rum, he liked to party and enjoy himself. But he inspired a god that everyone knows, Dionysus. Dionysus! Sorry, I've been drinking all day and it's 7 o'clock and we've been drinking all day. But Dionysus was the Greek god of wine. But back in the days, wine meant rum. Sugarcane syrup, fermented, and then drunk. That was wine. So forget about the wine you may have heard of with grapes and all that shit. It was wine from sugarcane. And that's what Dionysus was drinking. So the Greek god of wine, Dionysus, inspired by Silenus, was drinking rum. So when I did some research and looking at some of these old Greek vessels, when you go online and you go to the museums, you see all these old Greek vessels. This is a tiki. If this is not a tiki sherry bowl, I do not know what it is. This is from 500 BC. This is a tiki bowl. You put a nice little cocktail inside there and put that couple of straws and give that to your guests inside there. They're gonna be sipping that and sharing that. That is a tiki bowl. 500 BC, before Christ. That's the reason why tiki could have come from Greece. Look at this. This is 600 BC, a Greek tiki mug. If that is not a Greek tiki mug, you can see this in some of the museums here in Greece, in Athens. I don't know what tiki mug is. That is a tiki sharing bowl, as such. The Greek Riphon horn, they've traced this back to 2,500 years ago. Can you imagine drinking a Mai Tai or a zombie out of that? Of course you can! Of course! Because that's what it was there for, to drink something you enjoy. Nobody can tell me that the Greeks were not involved with the whole tiki culture, especially in this alternative world. Yeah? In the alternative world. So, Don the Beachcomber. Everyone know Don the Beachcomber? Don the Beachcomber is seen as the godfather of tiki bar culture. This is the guy that spent his money that his parents gave to him, his savings, to travel around the world to learn about different drinks and different cocktails in the 1920s. Actually, in fact, his dad said to him, you can either have the money for college, or you can travel around the world and drink lots of rum and hang out with loads of beautiful women and drink loads of rum and hang out with loads of beautiful women and drink loads of rum, or you can go to college. So what do you think he picked? Exactly, that's right. That's the reason why Don the Beachcomber became the godfather of tiki bar culture. Creating cocktails like the Tahitian Punch, the Navy Grog, the Fox Cutter, and the Zombie Punch. And I actually modeled myself after him because that's why I wear my hat, because he used to always wear a hat. That's it. Don the Beachcomber. So, a great bartender, a great host, a person that really encompassed what the bartender industry is about. It's about being the best hospitable coach out there. This is the reason why, personally, I don't go to bars where there's not a good host. I don't go to bars where you can't even sit in the bar. I want to go to a bar where you can feel good about yourself. And that's what a good bar is. And that's why tiki bars work so well in present climates, because you go there, you escape. You go to another world. There may be, a few years ago when I did a presentation similar to this, I was talking about Grexit. You guys rose above that and said, fuck Grexit, we're gonna stay in the European Union. I live in London, England, we have Brexit. And we have no idea what's going on. So I feel your pain. I felt your pain from 4 years ago. But you'd go to a bar to forget about Brexit and drink some great escapism cocktails and forget about the real world. And that's what you did in a tiki bar. Trader Vic, he was the spawn of Don the Beachcomber. A lot of people see a rivalry there, but Trader Vic had respect for Don the Beachcomber, the guy that created the whole tiki bar culture. Some of his cocktails were plagiarized or borrowed from some of his recipes as such. Of course, Trader Vic is known for the Mai Tai, which for me is one of the go-to cocktails out there. But he created Caribbean cocktails in an environment in the US that made people feel like they were in another world. And I feel that's important for a bar. So I just want to get some words of wisdom from Jeff Stavros Berry about this alternative world and what Trader Vic and Don the Beachcomber may have done if they were inspired by Greece.
So this is Mr. Jeff, not Stavros, Stavros, Jeff Stavros Berry, all the way from where are we actually?
We're in London,
Trader Vic's, you know that place that was inspired by the Greeks, of course. So, Mr. Berry, what would a bar be called if it was inspired by Greek tiki?
A Greek bar, of course.
A Greek, that makes sense, a Greek bar. And what type of cocktails would they drink? I mean, give us a recipe, one of your favorite recipes of a tiki cocktail that would be made by a Greek bartender.
Well, there's the Macedonian type.
Oh, Macedonia, that makes sense.
Which uses a little bit of Racina.
Okay.
A little lime juice.
Yep.
We've got some, well, of course, you have some Iraq.
Of course, it's some Iraq, yes.
And ouzo.
And ouzo.
And just as a little bit of a flavor enhancer, probably some Trisap liqueur, Mastika.
Mastika! Ooh, that sounds very Greek.
So, convention?
Yep.
Classic Greek convention that was in 1944 by Trader Mykonos.
Trader Mykonos.
That's right.
Brilliant, absolutely. So there you go, guys. You heard it.
A Greek cheeky, though.
Yeah.
There is a book that you need to read that delves into the history of Greece. And tiki, it's called Potions of the Caribbean. Caribbean being the birthplace of Greek tiki. It went from the Caribbean to Athens. It took a few hundred years, so there's many chapters about that journey. Bobby Stella.
I can't believe he's just plugging his book. I asked him to help you guys, and he's plugging his book.
It's the Greek one.
It's the Greek way. So that was Jeff Stavros Berry, the demigod, the legend of tiki history, cocktails, paraphernalia, basically saying in an alternative world that, Don the Beachcomber and Trader Vic could have been inspired by the Greeks for their tiki concoctions as such. I'm trying to remember what drinks you have. I don't know what you ordered. Is that the second drink you brought out, or the first drink? Is that the first drink or second drink? What was the first one? Straight rum, or was it cocktails? Cocktails. I have no idea what you ordered because it's 7 o'clock, 7:15. So I'll get to that. Is that zombie? Okay, zombie. Apparently it's a zombie, but we'll get to that a little bit further. So get back to the story. So Don the Beachcomber and Trader Vic have traveled to Greece. They haven't traveled to the Caribbean, Because a lot of people, when they think of tiki, they think of Hawaii, Tahiti, they think of the Polynesians. But no, the drinks for tiki have been inspired by the Caribbean. Yeah, especially the English Caribbean. Countries like Jamaica, Yaman. Trinidad. Queen Swat Swizzle. Cuba, Spanish, but not English. But that is what inspired Tiki, those islands in the Caribbean. It wasn't Tahiti, Easter Island, Hawaii, all those places, because they don't do rum. Well, they do rum, but not good rum. Shit, no one's filming this shit, are they? They do rum, but it's not that great. So all the cocktails, all the drinks that are based around Tiki are English, Spanish, and some French, Caribbean. And that's what inspired these greats. But imagine if they were inspired by Greece. So if Donda Beachcomber and Trader Vicar come to Greece, instead of being inspired by and creating mugs, tiki mugs based on statues from Easter Island, they would have been inspired by Greek statues. Yeah? And this is why I envy you guys in Greece. Because in England, we have some shit statues. They're really bad. But in Greece, you guys have like poets, you have philosophers, you have gods that are statues. And you can look at them like, oh my God, you know who that represents? And that is what inspires someone that wants to create a great cocktail. So when you see statues like this, you're like, amazing. And when you see statues like this for the original tiki thing, yeah, you're looking amazing. Only thing I want to address with you guys from Greece, and maybe you guys can help me. I'm here. What's the temperature today? 25 degrees? 25 degrees? What's this all about? So these are Greek statues. And there is something in common here with all these statues. It's not that cold here in Greece. So what's that all about? What? You can explain to me? He's going to explain to me. Explain to me. Why are their dicks so small?
Back in ancient Greek, they were all about symmetry.
Symmetry?
Everything was about, if you have a big
No, there's no big there anyway. But
if you had, you thought that you were ugly. But
oh, right, so if you had a big dick, you were ugly.
Yeah, like that. Right. Because it was out of the symmetry. It was not familiar with the rest of the body.
Wow, I've just learned something new. So apparently, guys, if you had a big dick, you were ugly. And you, because it wasn't symmetrical. And this is the reason why the Greek statues, like Zeus over here and Hermes over here, have penises that type. But look at the tiki statues. Because I just never understood what the hell that was all about. But anyway, let's move swiftly on. Back to Don's journey to the travel. So he went to Greece, and he, in this alternative universe, and he was inspired. He was inspired by the philosophers of the world, people like Plato or Plato. This is a very famous saying. He was a wise man who invented rum. That's true, you go online, you can see that. And anything that goes online is true, remember that. Maybe you might have said beer, but I change it to rum. But it's a great thing. You're the wise man who invented rum. So Donda Beach goes back to the US, originally in the old world, with cocktails like the Zombie Punch, 1934, the Suffering Bastard, another great drink. Doesn't use much rum, but needs more rum. The Missionary's Downfall, anyone tried the Missionary's Downfall before? Yeah, great cocktail, blended up with mint and that type of thing. Gets mint in your teeth, like you're driving a motorcycle without a crash helmet. Yeah, like bugs in your teeth, yeah. Missionary Downfall. Well, it's a nice drink, but you've been in there. But no, he actually, you remember, in this alternate universe, he went to Greece. So he has cocktails named... I don't speak Greek, so I don't know what they were... What's that say? I have no idea what this is. But he creates a cocktail named that. Cocktails named I have no idea what that means either. But is it like zombie or something like that? Or no? No, it's not zombie? No? Oh, it's very okay. And then another cocktail. I have no idea what that says either. Because it's in Greek. But these are the cocktails that would have been created in the alternative universe. Not a suffering bastard and a zombie, it would have been whatever that says. So these could be found, these cocktails in an alternative universe could be found in any Greek cocktail book. If there were some. Has anyone? These guys are killing themselves laughing at me. Guys, are there any Greek cocktail books available? Because I tried hard, I was doing research, I was looking hard for, and I did find one. I found two. I found 69 naughty Greek cocktails. You read that? You dirty little lady. 69 naughty cocktails by Mike Aaron and Surviving the Malacca. I actually thought that was a cocktail book, it wasn't. I read that and was like, ooh, wow, that's a... tough story of an American bartender in New York. But yes, so I was trying to find these classic cocktails out there. But I did find one in the alternative universe, the complete Greek cookbook. And this not only has great Greek cuisine, it has Greek cocktails. And hopefully some of these drinks may inspire you to add them to your bar program. Because this is what I want you to do. Add to your bar program. So cocktails like the Atlas cocktail. Named after Atlas, the strongest person in the world. Held the whole world up on his back like this. I have no idea why he wants to do that. Like, hold the whole world, and the whole world moves around and he's just there. I have no idea. He never watches Netflix, but he's just holding the world up, drinking or making cocktails with some Demerara rum, some Calvados, some Cointreau apple juice, beautiful tasting drinks, some agave nectar. We were going to give you a sample of that, but how many cocktails have you served? Have you served two or three?
Two
cocktails. Have you done the rum yet? The straight rum? Oh, that's it, yeah, okay. All right, we'll get to that anyway. Prometheus Punch. Prometheus, this is the guy that actually took fire from the gods and gave to us humans. So if it wasn't for Prometheus, we'd have no fire. No fire. Imagine you guys, any of you guys smoke cigarettes. You would not be able to smoke cigarettes without Prometheus, because it would be very hard to smoke a cigarette without fire. And if you guys that like do campfires and burn shit, you won't be able to do that without Prometheus. But a punch is great. Lime juice. Zeus mix. Zeus mix is very similar to Don the Beach's mix. So it's a secret. I can't tell you what the ingredients are. And just like Don the Beachcomber, you kept it a secret just in case anyone stole your bartender and tried to take the recipe of a cocktail, and you couldn't because you didn't tell the bartender what was in it. So I'm not going to tell you what's in the Zeus mix. It's a secret. That's the Zeus mix. Jamaican rum, yeah man. Puerto Rican rum, Demerara rum. Because just like the tiki cocktails in this world, not the alternative world, tiki cocktails are layers of different rums. Not one rum, not two, but three. How many cocktails do you know that has three different vodkas? Not many. That's right. How many cocktails do you know that have three different tequilas? That's right. None. How many have three different whiskeys? None. Maybe two. Maybe a scotch and a bourbon. Smoky. But rum, you get maybe a Jamaican rum, which is a Puerto Rican rum, with the Demerara rum. Yeah, so that's a great thing about the rum category. You can do layers, different styles of rums from different regions. The Tzatziki Tiki Colada. This is one of my favorite drinks. I was going to make this today, but the supermarket I went to ran out of tzatziki. But it's a great recipe for a cocktail. Put this on your menu. Tzatziki Tiki Colada, light rum, London dry gin, half a cucumber, honey syrup, Greek yogurt. Has to be Greek yogurt. None of that fake shit from Russia. Greek yogurt has to be in there. So cream of coconut from Coco Real, some lemon juice. Blend all the ingredients. And blend it like, and if you don't have a blender in your bar, do what I do, you carry your own blender around. And you can always have a cocktail ready for you. Always have a cocktail ready. Yeah, always have a cocktail ready. Carry your own blender and make cocktails like the Tzatziki Tiki Colada. That's a great drink. If anyone makes puts on the menu, please invite me. I'll be there. But I found some old video. Because in this alternative world, there's lots of video. I found some old video of some Greek bartenders that were inspired by Trader Vic and Don the Beach after they were inspired by Greece. This is a small little tiny Greek bar in Cyprus, and this is them making a punch. Jamaica, because I see a lot of similarities between Jamaica and Greece. Instead of doing that whole shaking thing, and that's too much effort, you just blend it. Put it in the blender. Put it in the blender. You see me working hard. I'm working hard. So that's a Greek punch in an alternative world, an alternative universe. Actually, it might be this universe as well. But if anyone ever goes to Cyprus, go to Lost and Found, that's the type. You been there? You work there, don't you? Oh, you been there, okay. Well, you know how crazy they are. That's the alternative world of Greek tiki. But one of the things I found in research, and this is the only time I'm gonna get serious in this presentation, I did some research and found out that Greece has an important part of rum history. Important part. And it all starts off here in Amphipolis. Amphipolis? How do you say it?
Amphipolis.
Sorry? Amphipolis. Oh, there you go. It all starts up in Amphipolis. Amphipolis. Very important part. I didn't even know about this, and I learned this myself. I was Googling, I was doing research. And I went to Amphipolis. And in Amphipolis, there is a tomb, the Amphipolis tomb, a very important part of Greek history. And when you go into the tomb, they were digging and they were finding all types of things. They found like statues, they found an ancient city, they found even half a body in marble, they found lots of old shit inside there, because it was Greece, lots of old shit in Greece, yeah, it's true. But they also found some bottles. This is from Amphipoli, these original bottles. And when I saw that, I was like, oh shit, that's some old shit. And I was like, wow, what's in there? And they said, Ian, because that's my name, Ian. There may have been some rum in there. I'm like, get the fuck out of here. Rum? Really? I know I'm the rum ambassador, but are you serious? No, we did some tests. We did some tests. I don't even know what the scientific term is, but it's some tests. And they found sugar cane extract inside the bottles in, what's the name of the place? Amphipoli, that's it. In Amphipoli. They found sugar cane extract in this bottle of whatever. And it was thousands of years old. And what I think, what I surmise as a rum lover and a rum ambassador, I know about Alexander the Great. And he was from Macedonia, which is part of Greece at that time. And he was there, and he sent his generals out to the world. And in 625 BC, his general, Nerchus, this dude here, Nerchus, or maybe 300 BC, but that's different. But anyway, this guy here, Nerchus, he found, when he was in parts of Asia, he found a reed that produces honey without the aid of bees. Now what's that mean to us? It's a sugar cane. Squeeze the sugar cane juice, it produces a very sweet liquid. No bees, no bees to sting you and shit. Nothing worse than getting stung by a bee trying to get this honey. But with sugar cane, you just squeeze the shit and you got honey, you got sugar cane honey. And if you're a kappa, you say virgin honey, but that's another story. Are you serving that yet? Don't serve it yet. No, it's too early. You'll hold it back because they're going to drink it. I want to. That's the salute. Take it from him because he's black. Take it from him. He'll drink it and it's like, he's like me, he likes free rum. Anyway, where am I? Yes, so Nerchus, a native of Crete and son of Androtimus of Amphipoli? Amphipoli, that's it. A native of Amphipoli. So this is the reference that was documented and passed down from years. Nerchus, the general for Alexander the Great, said, we have found an Indian reed that produces honey, although there are no bees. So that's sugarcane. They found sugarcane in India and they brought that back to Macedonia. They brought it back to Greece as such, which means there was sugarcane growing in Greece in 325 BC. Before Christ, turned water into wine, before Christ did the whole sandals thing, and before Christ started walking on water and that type of stuff, they were drinking fermented sugarcane juice here in Greece before then. So you guys have a claim to rum or beer, fermented wine as such. Anyway, but I surmise that the first rum that was distilled in Europe was this rum, Malacca rum, probably about 2,500 years old, maybe 25 years old, depends on if it's Solera or not. But anyway, it's an unaged rum. Now you can bring it out, But I found out from research, this is the first rum ever created in Europe, Malacca rum. And you guys are to try the modern version of Malacca rum. This is what you got now in front of you. Have a nose, have a smell, have a taste. This is part of the alternative Greek history when it comes to tiki and to rums, Malacca rum. And now, I have no idea what Malacca means, but I've been coming to Greece for 10 years, and the very first time I came here, someone said, hey, Malacca, I thought it was my name. So every time someone said Malacca, I'm like, yeah, it's me. So when someone said, Ian, the Malacca rum, I'm like, oh shit, that's Ian's rum. That's us. So I want to share it with you because rum is made for sharing. Rum is like, have you got one? Hey, give her a Malacca rum. Hey, it's Malacca rum over here, Malacca rum, bro. Rum is made for sharing. Rum is made for sharing. So what you have in front of you now, have a nose, have a taste. Malacca rum. It's got a little bit of a little tiny bit of funk, a little bit of aniseed, maybe a little bit of Tipsoro, is it called? Tipsoro? Sorry? That's it, yeah, exactly. You're good, you are, you're good. That's it, almost Greek, you're almost Greek. It has a little bit of the Greek flavor and profile, the terroir. I'm glad the way I can get one.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Is this two? I get two! Whoa! That'll warm you up. Does that warm you up as it goes down? Yeah. That's Malacca rum. Drink a few of those, like Malacca, like whatever. Anyway, so, an unaged, rested rum. But the great thing about rums like this, and like rums in general, when it comes to the whole tiki vibe, is cocktails. Because not everyone can drink a rum straight, unless you're a professional drinker. Sorry? The name, Malacca rum. So yes, so actually Malacca actually comes from actually thought it was Asian. I thought it was Asian, like a god in Asia and that type of stuff. Because one of the cocktails that I recommended actually has Malacca gin in there. I think that was the first gin you had. Hey, how are you? Okay. Let me shake your hands. How you doing? Nice to meet you. Grab a seat, grab a seat. Did you get some Malacca rum? You did. You called me Malacca? That's my name. Can we get Malacca rum for this young lady here? One Malacca rum, please. Uh-huh. Two Malacca rums, go ahead. Uh-huh. If she needs what she needs too. Oh, well done. Excellent.
Cheers.
Yeah, cheers. Oh, quick question. Come on. In this day and age of equal rights for male and female, is there like a female version of Malacca? Is it like Malacca-ness? Or is Malacca mean both male and female? Or is there like, what's a woman's version? Malacca who? Say again? Malacca's many. Malacca's many. Shit, let me just write that down. That's a new word. Shit. I don't got a pen. I don't got a pen. Malacca's many. Is that what you are? Malacca's many. What? No, because I'm innocent. I have no idea. I just use I use the same word for everybody. Hey, Malacca, get out of my way. Malacca, give me a drink. Malacca, put some extra sugar in that cocktail. So yeah, it doesn't matter. Anyway, so the first drink you had today was, and I haven't named these drinks because I'm hoping some of you guys may contact me on Instagram or Facebook and say, Ian, the first drink should be called this. I may give you a little prize. But it's based on the Fog Cutter, the original cocktail created by Trinovic. As such, where they use rum, they use a brandy, they use gin, they use a cream sherry float, lemon juice, orange juice, and orgeat. But of course, in the alternative world, instead of using brandy, they use Metaxa. Of course, all right? Instead of normal gin, they use 2 minutes. Okay. Instead of normal gin, they use Malacca gin. Have you got a bottle of Malacca gin? You got the gin there, the Malacca gin? Maybe they use fake gin. Oh, okay. Wait, Malacca gin was created by Diageo, and it was really funny because I met up with the owners of Diageo and they were talking about a conference they had one day and they came with this new name because Malacca apparently means like a god or something like that in Asia, and they said, oh, we're going to do Malacca gin and that. And they presented it to the team, and then the Greek contingent of Diageo said, oh yeah, it sounds great, but do you know what Malacca means in Greece? So they didn't produce it for about 2 years. But they said, fuck it, let's just do it, because it tastes good. So yeah, there is a Malacca gin as well. Yeah, Tanqueray, that's right, Tanqueray Malacca. So Tanqueray Malacca gin, sherry float, and a bit of a Pinot Real puree. That was the first cocktail you tried. The second cocktail you tried was based on a zombie. Thank you, Fiona, for telling me, sorry, Fifi, for letting me know what we had as such. So we got Don's Secret mix of grapefruit and ginger ale, because the original Don's number two was a ginger and cinnamon mix. Ginger and cinnamon mix. Bit of falernum from Barbados. Malacca rum. Of course, some Ray and Nephew, because we need to get some Jamaican. Bit of Jamaican inside there. And a dash of Angostura bitters, because Daniel's here, over there, and six drops of ouzo, because it's Greek, and some grenadine, and some crushed ice. And the last one, have we had all the drinks? We had four drinks already? How many drinks do you have? You have four drinks already? Oh shit, you guys are good. You guys are really good. You need more money. And the last drink you had was based on Mai Tai, so you had 6 mils of Malacca rum. I'm not going to tell you the recipe of Malacca rum, just in case you guys keep trying it. When did you finish? Basically, shit, it's sitting up there. Fuck. It's a blend of Ray Nephew and a bit of Sumeral. Fresh lime, orange juice, orge, and passion fruit, real. So, very important. So as we finish, I just want to finish up. And I hope you understand that everything I've said up until now is bullshit. It's not real. It's like when you watch a movie and someone does shit on the movie and you say, oh my god, that's amazing. That is not real. It's a movie. This is what I'm doing. I'm on stage talking shit. There's a little bit of truth in some of what I say, but most of it's bullshit. So this is a bartender in the fake world entering a cocktail competition. He is Greek and he wants to try to impress me as a judge.
Hi, my name is Alex. I'm from China Happiness in Portobello, Notting Hill. Let's start off with a nice shot of rum, as we do at the beginning of the comp. It's a nice blend of all of these very fine rums here. Strong rum here. Start off with a nice positive navy stroke. Then moving 100 years forward from the 1627 bike, which we'll talk about in a minute, and be quite relevant with the whole English naval thing. So a nice healthy measure of pluses. Yay much. And moving to Mauritius, to nice green island, 75.5% rum. About yay, just a little bit, yeah, a little bit extra, just a touch more. And then some Telambic, nice good hearty Telambic 151, same company. About that much. And going over to Bermuda, Northern Caribbean. Some nice toffee, banana-y heavy 1.5 rum. They're quite cheap in Bermuda, they don't even have a bag of tops. There we go. And just touch, just a hint toffee. And then from your lovely country of origin, yeah, Ray, Uncle Ray.
Yeah, man.
Lovely Uncle Ray, yeah. Just being there. And then, like I was saying, moving 100 years forward from 1627. So we've got a little bit of cinnamon here. We've got some nutmeg. And a lovely handy little plastic container with some cloves. Few cloves, some bitters, because as you know, when you've got 17, 18 ingredients in a tiki drink, bitters always helps, just a dash always helps out. It always makes flavors kind of blend them all together. You know, you've got some sugar there, some brown sugar, and lots of sugar, lovely. And we've got some actual blackstrap molasses, which you all know this vodka is made from. The occasional gin, just molasses there. Awesome. Healthy measure of some fresh lime juice, but some passion fruit juice, which is lovely, nice and fresh. Then you get my pirate swivel stick, get up a little bit of ice. I'm just gonna swivel it there for a while. Then I'm gonna get a nice, thick, gooey navel consistency. Oh, you're eating? That's something. Good. Nice. Use that end as well. It's the wood, it takes all the flavour and sucks it in. So you've got to use the other side. Just get the rest of that rum No, no. Yeah. I forgot to put in the one fast one. And right. Okay. So that's all in there, let's give that a little taste. Make sure it's right. Awesome. Nice and cold. Too much dilution. I'll spray my down like a thing. And we're gonna garnish this with an awesome little pirate ship. I made it a little fire ship. I'm gonna finish it off by setting it on fire. There's your fire ship.
That's a cocktail in an alternative universe, but anyway, guys, I'd like to thank you for giving me your time. We'll finish up there. Remember, we are in Athens, one of the most amazing cities in the world. There's lots of parties happening tonight. Do not end up like these vodka drinkers. I don't want to see anyone outside, clumsies or barrio, negro, what is called it? Yeah, you know? I don't see you looking like this. I don't want to see you anyone looking like that, because that's the vodka drinkers out there. So guys, thank you. Remember, rum is fun. Rum is fun. rum is fun! I will see you if next year if they let me into this country again. But thank you and Yamas!